It has been over 2 years since I covered Elden Ring on this channel, and with the recent release of the Shadow of the Erdtree 3 expansion, the video I made has gained quite a bit of popularity recently. And given that there are no major releases this month, I thought this would be the perfect time to make an updated optimization guide, to discuss some of the issues the game still has since the original release, explore some great mods that can improve the experience, and take another look at each and every graphics setting to examine the performance and visual impact of each one in the new map. So let's not waste any more time and let's get going. I want to start by discussing one major problem that still plagued this game since its release, which is stuttering caused by bad CPU usage. Now this has nothing to do with shader compilation stutter. Even after playing for a long time and exploring every area and every place, the game continues to exhibit stuttering and an overall inconsistent performance and frame times when traversing the map or engaging in combat. And when taking a closer look at the CPU usage, we can see that the game is heavily single-threaded, relying mostly on CPU 0 and not distributing the workload across all threads. This can lead to stuttering, which will be more noticeable if you have a CPU with weaker single-core performance. And I want to make it clear that this video will not fix or alleviate this problem. The only ones who can address this are the developers at From Software. However, given that this issue has persisted for more than 2 years, I don't think they'll fix it, especially if it's a core problem in their engine or their DX12 implementation. Regarding image quality, the game doesn't offer a lot of options. There are no temporal upscalers here. There is only a single setting to control the game's TAA. And here at 1440p, we can see that even with the highest anti-aliasing, the game still exhibits a lot of shimmering around foliage and other fine details. And performance-wise, there is around 7% cost when enabling TAA with the highest quality. But if you are willing to play offline, there are some great mods that can improve the image quality. The first one is ERSS2, which introduces temporal supersampling and upscaling to the game, providing a range of options including DLSS, FSR3, and XeSS for both anti-aliasing and upscaling, along with a sharpening slider which is necessary to enhance the image clarity. And here, if we compare the game's highest TAA against DLAA, FSR3, and XeSS at native 1440p, we can see that all the new options offer better temporal stability compared to TAA. But of course, this is just a mod and there are some drawbacks. The most obvious one is how foliage in particular looks slightly less detailed with the new options, especially with FSR3 and XeSS. Additionally, there is a computational cost, with DLAA costing around 8%, FSR3 around 11%, and XeSS around 14%. The second mod, which I highly recommend, is a simple one. It removes the chromatic aberration effect that is used heavily in this game. And here you can see how removing this effect results in a much clearer and better image quality. And last but definitely not least, we have this one, which unlocks the frame rates and removes the 60 FPS cap. And I'll be using this mod throughout the video to accurately measure the performance impact of the settings. So let's jump right into these settings, starting with ray tracing. Now there are two ray tracing effects in this game. First, we have ray traced ambient occlusion, which replaces SSAO and provides better ambient shading, especially on grass and foliage. And going from low to the higher options reduces the amount of noise visible in RTAO. The second ray tracing effect is ray traced shadows. This replaces the game's shadow maps with more accurate shadows that become softer the further away they are from the object casting them. And pushing ray tracing higher increases the amount of softness of these shadows. In terms of performance, ray tracing is so demanding in this game. Here in this scene, going from off to low, medium, and high costs around 34%, and going to max about 41%. So here I think the visual benefits of ray tracing don't justify its high performance cost, which is why I recommend leaving ray tracing disabled. Moving on to textures, this one controls the quality of some textures in addition to anisotropic filtering, and the most noticeable difference in texture quality occurs when moving from low to medium, while higher options don't significantly impact texture details. And VRAM requirements in Elden Ring are very low, and most modern and even older GPUs will not have any VRAM issues with this game. In terms of performance, going from low to medium costs around 5%, and going to max around 6%. So here, due to the low VRAM usage and the minimal performance difference between medium and max, I recommend keeping textures at max. Next we have SSAO, which adjusts the quality and intensity of screen space ambient occlusion, and both high and max look pretty much identical and provide darker and more intense AO compared to medium. In terms of performance, going from off to even max costs around 3%, so here I recommend keeping SSAO at max. Moving on to depth of field and motion blur. In Elden Ring, the depth of field effect is primarily used in cutscenes, and this setting controls the intensity of this effect. And performance-wise, there is a small impact of around 3-4% when going from off to max. Motion blur also has a negligible performance impact, so if you like these effects, don't worry about the performance and keep them on the highest quality. Shadow quality controls the resolution and detail of the shadow maps, and visually both high and max provide acceptable shadow quality compared to low and medium. On the performance side, there is around 3% cost when going from low to high and 10% when going to max. Therefore, I recommend keeping the shadows at high. Next, we have lighting quality. This one, when set above low, makes some light sources cast shadows, as you can see here, and going from medium to max doesn't show any visual benefits. However, this setting also affects the draw distance of lights, and here we can see a visual difference with more distant lights visible at max compared to the other options. In terms of performance, going from low to medium, high, and max costs around 6%, and here in the other scene, the performance impact is less significant, with around 3% when going from low to max. So here I recommend keeping lighting quality at max, and use low only if you are noticing performance drops near shadow casting lights. Moving on to effects quality, this one controls the quality of all the visual effects in the game, from particles generated by special weapon skills to other effects like fire, smoke, and more. It also adjusts the draw distance of these effects, as you can see here, where there are more torches visible with the higher options. Performance wise, it's hard to precisely measure the impact of this setting, but here we can see that going from low to medium, high, and max costs around 6-7%. However, I have noticed a bug in this new DLC map, particularly near waterfalls. Like here, where using max causes significant performance drops with low GPU usage, and I have also noticed the same problem on the 4070 Super, and it seems that lowering this setting to medium resolves this issue. Therefore, I recommend sticking with medium effects quality. But if you notice significant performance drops during boss fights, which often have a lot of visual effects on screen, consider using low instead. Volumetric quality adjusts the resolution of volumetric effects and lighting, such as light shafts and fog. At higher options, these effects appear more defined with fewer jagged edges. Additionally, at low and medium, there is noticeable noise in these effects during motion, which is less apparent at high and max. Performance-wise, this is one of the most demanding settings in this game. Here, going from low to medium costs around 2%, to high 6%, and to max 21%. But in some other areas with foggy weather, like here, the impact is more significant, with 10% to high and 27% to max. So here, I recommend medium or high volumetric quality. Reflection quality controls the quality of screen space reflections. Like here, we can see that more of the objects from screen space are included in the reflection with max compared to low and high. Performance-wise, reflections don't have a significant impact in this game. Therefore, I recommend keeping reflections at max. Next, we have water surface quality. This one, when set to high, enables a ripple effect when interacting with water. And similar to reflections, it has no significant performance impact, which is why I recommend keeping it at high. Shader quality has been a bit of an enigma since it first appeared in Dark Souls 3. No one knew the visual impact of this setting, and even in my previous Elden Ring video, I couldn't find any visual or performance difference. But with an updated game and a new map, I examined several shaders and surfaces hoping to find a difference, and eventually I come across an area where I noticed something strange. If you look closely, you can see that with high, water interacts differently with this rock compared to low and medium. It's almost as if there is more water at high. So I moved on to another scene, and here the difference was more pronounced, with waves visible in the distance and water flowing over and around these rocks at high, unlike low and medium. And it seems like this setting primarily affects flowing or running water, as still water don't show any visual difference between low and high. Performance wise at this scene, going from low and medium to high costs around 6%, and in the previous scene there is around 3% between low and high, so here I recommend keeping this one at high. Global illumination controls the quality of diffuse and indirect lighting. Like here, we can see that medium and high offer significantly better and more accurate ambient lighting compared to low. In terms of performance, there is no significant impact even when going from low to high. Therefore, I recommend high global illumination. Finally, we have grass quality. This one adjusts the density and distance of grass rendering. Like here, we can see more grass both up close and in the distance with high and max compared to medium. And as a result, medium exhibits more noticeable grass popping than high and max. In terms of performance, going from medium to high and max costs around 4 to 5%. So here I recommend high or max grass quality. And with all that being said, these are my recommended settings for Elden Ring. In this three-way comparison, we have max settings on the left, optimized settings in the middle, and on the right we have optimized settings but with shadows, volumetrics, and grass dropped to medium. And in terms of performance in this area, the optimized settings on average improve performance by around 19%, while the optimized settings with medium shadows, volumetrics, and grass offer around 29% better performance. And with that, we arrive at the end. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.